ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः। गुणातीतमानं चिदानंदरूपं चिदाभासकं सर्वगं ध्यानगम्यं मुनिध्येयमाकाशरूपं परेशं परब्रह्मरूपं गणेशं भजेमा। टीम परम वेदांत एक्सटेंड्स अ वार्म वेलकम टू द 52nd सेशन ऑफ भगवद्गीता वर्स बाय वर्स, विशिंग यू ऑल अ वेरी हैप्पी दीपावली। Let's dwell upon the spiritual significance of this festival to begin with. There are various alleged origins attributed to this festival. Some hold that they celebrate the marriage of Lakshmi with Lord Vishnu. It also commemorates the blessed day on which the triumphant Lord Rama returned to Ayodhya after defeating Ravana. On this day, Shri Krishna killed the demon Narakasura. It is also in honor of the King Bali, who went to rule the nether world by the order of Vishnu, and this is the day Bali is allowed to return to earth once a year. This is the day Lord Shiva accepted Shakti into the left half of the form and appeared as Ardhanarishvara on goddess completing her 21 days of austerity known as Kedara Vrata. Govardhana Puja is also celebrated to mark the defeat of Indra when Krishna lifted the Govardhan Parvat. They light fireworks, which are regarded as the effigies of Narakasura. Oil bath in the Brahma Muhurta is regarded as purifying as a bath in the holy Ganga. Deepavali is the time to give and forgive, rise and shine, unite and unify, prosper and progress, and more importantly, illuminate one's inner self. The light of lights, the self-luminous inner light of the self, is ever shining steadily within. Withdraw the senses, fix the mind on this supreme light, and enjoy the real Deepavali by attaining illumination of the self, says Swami Shivananda. Let's recall this verse from Kathopanishad. Na tatra suryo bhati na chandra tarakam, nema vidyuto bhanti kuto ayamagnihi, tameva bhantam anubhati sarvam, tasya bhasa sarvamidam vibhati. The sun does not shine there, nor do the moon and the stars, nor do the lightning shine, and much less the fire. All the lights of the world cannot be compared even to a ray of the inner light of the self. Merge yourself in this light of lights and enjoy the supreme Deepavali. The spiritual significance that underpins Diwali is that we need to light up our inner selves first if we wish to dispel the darkness within as well as the darkness without. Coming back to today's session, we completed 7th chapter in the previous session. Before we begin our foray into the 8th chapter, we take a detour as always. In today's session, we take up Ramana Maharshi's Upadesha Saram from where we left earlier. We had covered the first 15 verses dealing with the karma, bhakti and raja yoga. Today we take up next 7 verses, that is number 16 to 22, dealing with jnana yoga. These verses will be explained by Dr. Ravi Shankar, Dr. Vikram Kekatpure, Dr. Sachin and myself. Our revered teacher, Dr. Timappa Hegde sir, will present 3 verses in addition to weaving together all the verses with his enriching wisdom. Today's verses will be chanted by Kumari Aditi. Let's visualize that we are sitting in Bhagavan's presence in Arunachala and tune in ourselves to the essence of these verses. Over to you, Guruji.
Thank you, Dr. Vasumati, for a nice introduction and also for the nice season's greetings. Sadashiva Samarambam Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Pariyantam Vande Guru Paramparam Om. As introduced by Dr. Vasumati, we have finished the 7th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, and before we start the next chapter, we have started the practice of introducing a Vedanta topic. In the last session, that means after the 6th and before the 7th, we completed the first 15 verses of this most wonderful text by Bhagavan Ramana, the Upadesha Sara. Today we continue from verse 16. We will be covering 7 verses, and these are really cryptic and difficult to understand. Those who have had an Upanishadic background will find it relatively easier. Swami Anubhavananda calls Upadesha Sara as Upanishada Sara. And therefore, a little background of the Upanishads will be able to help us to understand. The way Bhagwan Ramana has brought out the Vedantic truths is so simple and so direct that every student of Vedanta will find the methodology followed by Bhagwan Ramana as a very easy method to understand Vedanta. So we begin the whole process of Jnana Yoga or Atma Vichara. The first stage is, as I've shown you on this illustration, how the world is reduced to thoughts of the world. For example, if I'm seeing a tree, the experience of seeing, although the tree is outside, I will see the tree inside the two eyes as a tiny image. So the tree, which is real outside, has now become two images in my two eyes. Subsequently, from the eyes, it becomes transformed into neural signals and it is reported into the brain. And the two trees, which were upside down in the two eyes, now become one single tree that I can see and experience. And I see the tree as a thought of the tree. Now, this is important to understand. The whole world has now been reduced into thoughts of the world. Bhagwan Ramana has given certain new terms. Now, this tree thought that is there, he calls this as idam vritti. So this idam vritti is seen by another thought. What is the other thought? I am seeing that tree, and that is called aham vritti. And Bhagwan also reminds us, it is because I am conscious, and that consciousness is called aham. So the whole journey is from idam vritti to aham vritti to aham. If you can see in this illustration, this is a type of an illustration to say what is going on in our mind. Our mind is full of thoughts. All the objects that I see in the world or anything that I can think of is only a thought. I can have a car thought or a baby thought or a house or a tree. All these are various thoughts. In addition to these hundreds of thoughts, which Bhagwan calls them as idam vritti, there is another central thought called aham vritti. I am seeing the tree. I am seeing a car. I am seeing a bird. So this central one thought, which is supporting all these thoughts, is called aham vritti. And we know that aham vritti is also supported by aham. Now, our entire class will be a repetition of these three terms. And one of the reasons why we will repeat is we have to understand in Vedanta two terms. What is Sat and what is Chit? Sat also means existent. Chit means consciousness. These are the two terms in Vedanta a student has to be absolutely clear. If these two terms are clear, Vedanta becomes very clear. If these two terms are not clear, what I would like to say is it takes months to years for this understanding. And just as I've shown in these illustrations, if you have to go to a high altitude place, now we are showing Mount Everest. Now, climbers will have to stop at various base camps to be able to acclimatize. They cannot go to the next level until their bodies have been acclimatized to the rarefied atmosphere. Now, what we are going to see, and today Dr. Sachin is going to explain based on the Taittiriya Upanishad, how Bhagwan explains how we do this process of acclimatization. To understand what is Sat and what is Chit requires our mind to become very sensitive. And this is the process of acclimatization. Bhagwan Ramana had a very charismatic and a magnetic presence. All those who have described him feel that in his very presence, a radiant calmness, and whatever problems that you go in his presence, just sitting in silence with him, all your problems seem to disappear. Bhagwan is also known as a master of silence because he hardly communicates, if at all he would speak in few words in reply to a question. In general, why do people meet a great master because they have a lot of problems. And if at all somebody speaks, it is all about their problems. Whenever somebody presents Bhagwan with his problem, his first question is, who has this problem? The usual answer is, I have this problem, Bhagwan. His first approach is, inquire who is this I, Nana Yar. Make this inquiry into who you are. Today's class will be looking into Atma Vichara, or this who am I inquiry. Meaningful inquiry into Atma Vichara is possible only, I will say only, when we are ready to believe that I am someone other than my body. As long as I identify with this body, I have absolutely no doubts about who am I. But if somebody is able to tell us that I have existed even before this body came into being, I will continue to exist even after this body ceases to be. And if I look into my own life, I was once a small baby, then I have grown up. My body has undergone so many changes, but I am the indweller within the body is the same. Then the real question is, I am someone other than the body. So meaningful Atma Vichara is possible only when somebody is able to say or accept that I can be someone other than the body. Meaningful inquiry can be possible only with the help of a guru and shastra. Gurus and shastras give us a methodology. We are so blessed to have a teacher like Swami Paramarthananda Ji, who helps us to work this process in a very methodical manner. Swamiji has given us what is called fundamental laws of Vedanta. The first fundamental law of Vedanta, and let us practice this from now on, and that will be coming in today's class very soon, is I am someone other than whatever I see and experience. I see so many objects around me. I'm very clear I am not any of one of them. But we have to see that I see my body, I see my mind. That is where this fundamental law of Vedanta applies. That means I am not my body. I can see my mind trying to explain something to you. I am not my mind. In our scriptures, this methodology is called Drik Drishya Viveka. The real seer in me is Drik. This body-mind complex is drishyam. I need to clearly see I am not the body, I am not the mind. The anxiety of my mind is something that is happening on my mind. I am the observer of the anxiety in my mind. The aging of my body is the aging of my body. It is not my aging. So too is the sickness or the death of the body. I am the witness, I am the sakshi of this aging body, this anxious mind. I am someone other than my body and mind, period. This is the first and important step in Drik Drishya Viveka or Vedanta Vichara. Only when I am able to do this, I am able to proceed. Let us proceed with Atma Vichara by meditating on the words, I am. Whenever you say am, asmi, aham, asmi, what does it mean? Asmi means I am existent. About my existence, I am absolutely certain. I don't need anybody to prove that I am existent or not. We all know we are existent. We all can certainly say I. Only a conscious person can say I. That means, what is my true nature? My true nature is I am. The moment I say I'm a doctor, I'm a man, I'm an Indian, I have brought in an Atma. The Atma aspect, the true me is I am. The other beautiful thing is, to know anything in this world, I need my sense organs or my mind to confirm. But to know I am, I don't need any sense organs, any mind. Even in pitch darkness, I don't have to verify this. I know I am. And our teachers repeatedly tell us that knowledge which does not need the mind and the sense organs is the real me. And that is what I need to be very clear, that I am I am Atma. Anything else that I see and experience is Anatma. And this is the first step in meditating. And as long as you remain at I am, there is no problem. The moment you say, I am a man, I'm an Indian, I'm a doctor, I'm this, I enter into the domain of Anatma. There is a beautiful verse in, there are many such verses, but Sri Dakshinamurti has elaborated on this conscious existence. Wherever in scriptures you come across verses which are talking about conscious existence, Swami Paramatmananda goes into a detailed explanation. And it is these verses which help us to understand this conscious existence that I am. With this background, let us go into, I have taken the string of verses 16, 17, and 18 because they are all linked together. And let us see the first verse. Drishyavaritam chittam atmanaha chitvadarshanam tatvadarshanam. What do you mean by drishyavaritam? Drishya means whatever objects that I can experience through this process of self-inquiry, I have to negate as anatma, not me. Mano buddhi hankara chittani naham. I am none of these. Once I negate everything, I negate my body, I negate my mind, then I come across the negator. This is called the neti nisheda method. The one who's negating is Chidananda Rupaha Shivoham. And that is what Bhagavan says is, the more you become aware of that conscious entity, that is the truth, that is Tattva Darshanam. I will read. Drishyavaritam chittam atmanaha. With this process of self-inquiry, the mind negates all objects of my experience, including my body and mind. It finally leaves with chitva darshanam. I become aware of my own consciousness, which is doing this process of negating. And that consciousness in me, Bhagwan declares, is none other than the truth. And this is Jivatma Paramatma Aikyam. This is the real me. This is what Sri Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita in the 13th chapter, where he says, Kshetrajnam Chapi Mam Vidhi Sarva Kshetreshu Bharata. I am the experiencer in everything. This is the key verse. That is the verse 16, which is the seed verse for the rest of the verses that we're going to study today. Verse 17 is another beautiful verse. We need to remember this by heart. It is an often quoted verse. Manasantu kim margane krite naiva manasam marge arjavat. This is Bhagavan's methodology where he says, again, a path of inquiry. Manasantu kim. What is this thing called the mind? Iti marga nekrite, if you inquire in this manner, you will see naiva manasam. There is no real substance called the mind. As I've already said, what is this mind? This mind is full of idam vritti and aham vritti. None of them are as real as aham. So if you start this process of negation, you will realize there is no thing or no substance called mind. Again, for emphasis, I will go through this once again. Kim margane krite, when you inquire in this manner, manasintu kim, what is this mind? You will see the mind is the bunch of thoughts, idam vritti and aham vritti. And as I said, the tree is real, but the thought of the tree which is there in my mind is virtual. It is not as real, not as substantial. Naiva manasam, you will see there is really no substance called the mind. And this is Bhagavan's path. And what is this Bhagavan's path? So let us understand this, because this is very difficult to understand. Bhagavan says, the existence of the world depends upon one's perception. That means it is a conscious individual that can prove existence. I will say it in other words. If there is something in this world that can never be verified by anybody at any time, that something is as good as non-existent. I will say it in other words. Now, in this room, let us say There are only two or three people in this room, but I will say there are 50 people in this room. But then I will tell you, those 48 people cannot be seen by anybody at any time. Would you believe? That means to prove the existence of all the people, it requires someone or the other to consciously verify. That means consciousness proves existence. If something cannot be proved, that something's existence can never be verified. Perception of anything takes place in the form of a thought. So the world depends upon one's thoughts for existence, and therefore the world has a dependent existence. Swamiji gives a nice example by saying, if a person's beauty is dependent on the dress and ornaments, such a beauty is not a real beauty. That means anything dependent on something is not as real as something that is independent. So we need to see what is really dependent and what is independent. If you look into our minds, there are three words which Bhagwan uses all the time: idam vritti, aham vritti, and aham. All these worldly thoughts, the window thought, the clothes, the table, the chair, are all thoughts in the mind. These hundreds of thoughts are called idam vritti. All of these thoughts are supported by, I am seeing the table, I am seeing the chair, I am seeing the computer. So there is one central thought called the aham vritti. And this aham vritti is supported by consciousness or aham. The word aham means that which cannot be killed. So again, a repetition. Bhagwan says this is I thought or ahankara is also a dependent on Atma or consciousness. Why is that? Because this I thought is subject to arrival and departure. For example, when you go to sleep, the mind ceases to be, but the consciousness is always there. So the whole process is from the world of thoughts to the I thought to consciousness. That is the real journey. Now, again, a repetition. The world does not exist separate from the mind. Mind is also called idam vritti. The mind idam vritti does not, the mind idam vritti, all the thoughts, does not exist separate from the ego or the ahankara. And the ahankara cannot exist without the support of consciousness. Now, all our problems in this world is because of our ahankara. And that is why all spiritual teachers try to help us to see that if we can work on this mithya ahankara, and you will see nice verses that come. So the final word that verse that I have to explain today is vrittya tu aham vritti ashrita vrittayo manaha viddi aham manaha. Now Bhagwan is trying to explain what is this thing called the mind. He says vrittayo manaha. Again, you will see a repetition because these are subtle things and Bhagwan wants us to understand. The mind is full of thoughts. What thoughts? Idam vritti. Vrittaya aham vritti ashrita. So all these idam vrittis are supported by that I thought or ahankara or this aham vritti. Bhagwan firmly concludes, viddi, therefore know that aham manaha, the mind is this I thought. So the mind is primarily the I thought or ahankara, which is supporting all these idam vritti. What happens during sleep? When the mind, during sleep, the mind has resolved. There are no thoughts at all. And when there is no thoughts, there is no samsara. And that is why if we are able to negate the mind, if you are able to give less importance to the mind, you give importance to what we need to do. But you know, the mind has a habit of projection, and that is the cause of all our problems. We will continue the discussion on a related verse, which will be explained to us by Dr. Ravi Shankar. Over to you, Dr. Ravi Shankar.
Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. Ahamayam kuto bhavati chinvataha aipatatyaham nija vicharanam. The I thought of or ego, which depends on the consciousness for its existence, is the gist of the verse here given by Bhagwan Ramana Sadguru. We notice in the next slide that the true self-inquiry of I is very subtle. This I with the double inverted comma is the original consciousness explained as Bimba or the Atma Chaitanya, which is invisible and the only Satya. The I with the single inverted comma is the reflected consciousness or the Pratibimba, which is visible and is Mithya. The mind is a mirror. When clear, the image is clear. And when it is covered with dust or moisture, the reflection is unclear. This ego is a combination of the original consciousness, the reflected consciousness, and our mind with its qualities and impurities. In the next slide, it is further explained. This subject or bimba has its location outside the mirror, which is our mind, which is myself. There is no need to search for it. In fact, to search for it is the mistake. The object Pratibimba has its location on our mind. When we inquire about this object, the mind and the Pratibimba both disappear. To separate the I from the mind or the ego is self-inquiry. And that is mentioned in this verse as Nicha Vicharanam or Atma Vicharanam. Only with self-inquiry is self-knowledge possible. In the next slide, we notice Swami Paramarthanandaji clearly explaining that this I is the Atma. It is never the observed object. It is ever the observer subject. My own image on the mind, which is the mirror, is the Atma Abhasa or the Ahankara. And that is the object of experience. And this Ahankara fluctuates depending on the condition of the mind. If the mind has happy thoughts, the Ahankara is a happy I. If the mind has depressive thoughts, the Ahankara is depressed, is a depressed I. Jnana Yoga is explained in the next verse as very difficult and abstract. This individualistic I comes and goes and is called as Ahankara in Vedanta. It resolves in deep sleep. It comes alive in wakefulness. It is not pride or arrogance, but individuality. The object Ahankara, which is the I with the single comma, comes and goes, and it should be disowned. But the subject I is Atma, which always remains in all its plenitude and perfection and must be claimed. We notice in the next slide, like a dog which always remembers the master's scent, one must always go back to the source of the I thought. Like camphor which dissolves on burning, and the wood which is used to light a pyre is consumed in the same fire, so too the mind resolves on inquiry, though the same mind is used for this inquiry. The process of Nija Vichara is Upasana, and when it is permanent, it is Jnanam. Swami Anubhavanandaji explains this verse by saying, see the continuous presence in everything, that which illumines all experiences, without getting involved. The more we are in the present, the mind nears its death. The thought, I am this body-mind complex, is one thick, big string to which all other thoughts are tied. Hari Om, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Ravi Shankar. This is another related verse which says, Aham ayam kuto bhavati chinbata ai patatyati aham nija vicharanam. Again, as Dr. Ravi Shankar has been explained, the more we inquire, you will see whatever is unreal disappears. He says, supposing you inquire in this manner, kutaha, who is this I thought? If you are able to inquire, it is a great wonder. It's a great exclamation that the I thought disappears. This is true self-inquiry, which means the more you begin to inquire on your real nature, the one that we have invested so much on this pseudo sense of my ego as to who I am and the sense of false importance, the more we negate this, most of our problems in the world will resolve. Bhagwan Ramana has a very favorite story of one Narayana in a wedding party. In the traditional weddings, the groom's party and the bride's party come to a wedding hall, and there are two sections where the groom's party would stay and the bride's party would stay. And there was one common person called Narayana who befriended both the groups, and he was absolutely helpful. He knew the place in and out. He would give whatever help that was required. Now, because they did not know who this person was, and he was so friendly, each one assumed that he belonged to the other party. The bride's party thought he belonged to the groom's party, and the groom party thought he belonged to the bride's party. After winning the confidence of all the people, when everything was over, the two families got together and were discussing about this wonderful Narayana. And suddenly they realized that no one knew who this person was. And when they began to inquire who this Narayana was, Narayana disappeared with all the jewelry that he had access to. Bhagwan was trying to say, the more you inquire into a pseudo entity, into a false entity, the false entity will disappear. The next verse, verse 20, will be explained by Dr. Vikram. Over.
Hari Om, Shri Guru Bhyo Namaha. Bhagwan Ramana has packed in these verses entire Vedantic teaching, starting with karma and karma yoga, upasana yoga, ashtanga yoga, and now he is describing a very subtle topic of jnana yoga in this set of verses. The spiritual journey, as we have seen in last few verses, begins with idam vritti, that is everything else other than ourself, our mind, that is the outer world. On deeper inquiry, there is a realization that idam vritti, that is the differentiation between me and the world, is creation of our mind. This mind is described here as aham vritti. Mind is like a mirror which projects image as we perceive ourselves and the world. Just as with different mirrors, this image of the world changes according to the state of our mind. For example, if mind is happy, everything seems to be nice and pleasant. However, if mind is occupied by disturbing thoughts, everything is unpleasant. And this image which is perceived is nothing but our ego or ahamkara, which is reflected self, also aham vritti. On further inquiry on spiritual path, where does the ego rest? The ego has no separate existence from consciousness. Ego is in fact the reflected consciousness, as the original consciousness is covered or influenced by the thoughts in the mind. Uncovering the true nature through jnana yoga is the spiritual journey. From idam vritti to aham vritti to destruction of ego to realization of the true consciousness. How to do this is discussed in verse 20. Next slide. Let's look at the verse 20. Ahami nashabhyam maham aham taya spurti hrut swayam param purna sat. Word by word meaning, aham nashabhyaji. When aham vritti, that is the ego or ahankara, is destroyed, aham aham taya, the real I, hrut, that is the pure consciousness, spurti, shines forth, swayam, that is on its own, param purna sat, as limitless, timeless, original consciousness, which has a permanent, unnegatable entity. Next slide. The spiritual journey is disowning the pseudo I and getting anchored in real I or pure consciousness. It is like peeling a layer upon layer to reach the final destination. First shift is idam vritti to aham vritti, or as mentioned in Drig Drishya Viveka, I, the experiencer, is different from the experience. The next shift is aham vritti to self-realization, that is all attributes belongs to object and not to the subject Atma. Then realizing that I am Atma, that is Sakshi Chaitanya, as quoted in केन उपनिषद श्रोत्रस्य श्रोत्रम मनसो मनः यत् वाचो यह वाच स उ प्राणस्य प्राण चक्षुश्च चक्षु इट इज द ईयर ऑफ द ईयर द माइंड ऑफ द माइंड्स द स्पीच ऑफ द स्पीच He is also the prana of the prana and the eye of the eye. Next slide. On path of Jnana Yoga, two important landmarks are to be achieved. Control and destruction of the thought and mind. And secondly, the renunciation of ego. Once these are destroyed, one realizes the true nature, the pure and the self-consciousness. Next, Sri Ramana describes few attributes of pure consciousness or Atma. Atma as original, next slide please. Atma is the original consciousness. It is the Chit principle. Always shining in timeless, it is timeless. Parampurna, absolute, limitless and all pervading. Atma is the existence principle. Existence presupposes knowability. Atma lends its existence to all creation. So in summary, Sri Ramana here is suggesting to drop and destroy the ego so as to realize the brilliance of Atma, which is Sat-Chit Atma, which is further elaborated in subsequent verses. Hari Om.
Thank you, Dr. Vikram, for a nice explanation of a key sadhana that all of us need to do. Is every spiritual teacher teaches us that the ego is the cause of all our problems. Our consciousness is always there. There is nothing that we need to do to realize our true self because it is, we are already that. But the ego seems to cover it. The more we are able to work on this ego, the word is ahami nasha bhaji. This ahami is the I thought. If you are able to successfully work on this ego. Now, the normal word ahankara sometimes is seen as pride. But in Vedanta, ahankara is given as an understanding that I am other than you. The idea that I have about this limited self. Now, once through Vedanta Vichara, I understand that this is a pseudo entity. It is only a functional for functional usefulness only. It does not have a real entity. The more I give mityatvam for that, then spurati hrit swayam, from my heart emerges that which was always there. What is that? Parama purna sat. Parama, it means the highest. Purna means the complete. Sat means sat or existence. The next verse will be explained to us by Dr. Vasumati. Over to you, Dr. Vasumati.
Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. The verse goes like this. Idamaham pada abhikyamanvaham ahamilinake pyalaya sattaya. Here Ramana Maharshi says, this Sat-Chit Atma alone is continuously there throughout the life without arrival or departure in all the three states of Jagrat, Swapna and Sushupti. Even when the ahankara goes away, I, the Atma, who is the witness of the absence of ahankara, that I, the Sakshi Chaitanya, never comes and goes. Bhagavan here is applying a particular law. Whatever is subject to arrival and departure is not my real nature because ahankara is subject to arrival and departure. It is incidental nature. That is why it comes and goes. Whereas the Chaitanyam never arrives and departs. Therefore, that alone has to be my intrinsic nature. Next slide, sir. To give an example to illustrate the incidental and intrinsic nature, suppose there is a fire of a stove. Upon the fire, a vessel is kept. In the vessel, we have water, and in the water, there are some vegetables. After some time, the vegetables will turn out to be hot. But we know vegetable is not hot naturally, but it is in contact with hot water. Therefore, vegetable has borrowed heat from water. Next question will be, why is the water hot? Water is not naturally hot. Water has borrowed heat from the vessel. Then we ask, why is the vessel hot? Vessel is not naturally hot, but it has borrowed heat from the fire. Finally, we ask, why is the fire hot? We don't say it has borrowed heat from the vessel. Fire is hot because heat is its intrinsic nature. So the heat of the vegetable, water, and vessel is incidental, while the heat of the fire is intrinsic. Fire neither borrows nor loses heat. It is always there. Whatever is not borrowed and whatever is not lost is intrinsic, and whatever comes and goes is incidental, not real nature. Next slide, sir. Ramana Maharshi says the word I, all the attributes that I talk about are all subject to arrival and departure. Physical features like boyhood and youth, etc., appear and disappear. Similarly, emotional personality, happy, sad, appears and disappears. Even ahankara, the individuality, is appearing in the waking state and disappearing in the deep sleep state. Therefore, none of them is my real nature. They are borrowed and given up. Then, what is that only thing which is unborrowed? The only thing that is the consciousness. I am a conscious being all the time. Next slide, sir. Therefore, Ramana Maharshi says, idam, that is this Paramapurna Satchit Atma, what was referred in the earlier verse, Paramapurna, Abhikya, alone, is Ahampada, is the real meaning of the word I. Thus, Atma alone is my real nature and not the Ahankara. What is the reason? Anvaham, every day, Ahamilina ke api, when the Ahankara resolves, that is, goes away in deep sleep state, the real I is always there, witnessing the absence of Ahankara as well as arrival of Ahankara. And therefore, Alaya Sattaya, without disappearing, that is, I don't disappear. Satta means existence. Because I have a non-disappearing existence even when Ahankara disappears. Therefore, that I, the witness consciousness, alone is the real Atma. Next slide, sir. What is the proof that I am existing in deep sleep? Proof is simple. If I have to talk about the deep sleep state in which Ahankara is absent, I must be aware of it. I can never talk about something that I have not experienced. For example, behind this wall, is there a person or not? That's a question. To say there is a person, we must go there and see. To say there is nobody there, then that is to talk about the absence of a person also, I must go there to see. Presence of things also requires a witness. Absence of things also requires a witness. In deep sleep state, I'm talking about the absence of Ahankara. The question will come, who is aware of the absence of Ahankara? To say in Swamiji's words, that awareer, that is the subject who is aware, must be the Atma. Therefore, the witness of Ahankara is the real I. Thank you, sir. Hari Om.
Thank you, Dr. Vasumati, for a nice explanation of a verse which is very central in understanding Vedanta. All Vedanta talks about asatoma satgamaya, from that which appears to be real to that which is real. If you look into our own lives, you will see there is something which is all the time changing. Our body mind is changing all the time. As you have shown those illustrations, from a small child to an old age, the human body undergoes so much variations. But the indweller, the person within, has never undergone a change. In Vedanta, it is said, whatever never undergoes change is called Sat. Whatever keeps on changing is not as real, it is called Asat. Bhagwan, in this example, uses the example of deep sleep. In deep sleep, every day, what happens is the Ahankara disappears. And when the Ahankara disappears, while we are asleep, we have no sense of who I am. I am during sleep, I am not a man, woman, Indian, or, you know, I have no sense of identity. I have no sense of time. I have no sense of space. Only when I wake up, I regain my ego. I regain my sense of identity. So that means this ego comes, this ego goes. But even when I have been asleep, once I wake up, I'm absolutely certain that I have slept well. Who is that which is there observing all the changes in my life? Now, this is what is called Vedanta Vichara. And when we inquire in this way, we will discover there is some factor in and through all the three stages of our life, waking, dream, deep sleep. There is an observer. There is a person who's been seeing all the changes, the non-changing observer. And Bhagwan is trying to draw our attention to the real I, which is Sat Chit Atma, in and through all these changes. We come to the final verse today, which will be explained by Dr. Sachin. Over to you, Dr. Sachin.
Hari Om. Om Guru Pyo Namaha. The verse goes like this. Vikrahendriya pranadhitama naham ekasat tachadam hasat. The meaning is, I am the consciousness, the one and only existence or the reality in the world. Aham ekam. And the five layers that are vikrahendriya pranadhimaha, these five layers are not me, as they are insentient and hence do not have an independent existence as the real consciousness. In the next slide, we see that as we have gone through the different names of consciousness as Sakshi Chaitanya, Parampurnaha, and the Aham, these topics of consciousness are always dry and abstract, difficult to understand due to its subtleness. It's inert, and our intellect, as we all have understood till now, it is inert. So it is a matter, jadam. So difficult to assimilate this topic. Through an example in the next slide, Swamiji explains us that a mountaineer, when wants to reach the heights, he has to acclimatize. Otherwise, if he doesn't acclimatize, he will have problems and he has to come down in the mountain climb. Similarly, we, the seekers of Vedanta, have to repeatedly undergo the satsanga, the shravanam. Then we have to meditate on it. And mananam and nididhyasanam should always be in our cards. Otherwise, there will be a spiritual downfall. So there is acclimatization, which is required. And in the next slide, we'll see there are two types. The first is objective, that which is around us like a srishti. And the second is subjective. So these two levels of acclimatization, what they are, is given in this verse. We'll see further in the next slide. The srishti or objective level is divided for our understanding and ease into earth, water, fire, air, and space. Earth is known to us through the five senses which we all carry all the time: shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, and gandha. But as we go more and more subtler, the water, the next level, only shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa can understand it, not the gandha. Fire could be understood only with shabda, sparsha, rupa, air with sabda, sparsha, and the space, the most subtlest of all, only silence can understand it. Coming to the next level of acclimatization, that is the subjective. In the next slide, we'll see a subjective level of personality, which we all know by now. The five koshas, Annamaya, Pranamaya, Manomaya, Vijnanamaya, and Anandamaya. As we go deeper into deeper our own understanding, these are the five koshas we are all born with. We sometimes misunderstand the Anandamaya kosha as the real consciousness, but no. All the five koshas, including Anandamaya here, is the jadam. So that's what is told in this verse, tat jadam. All these five koshas are jadam. And what in the next slide we'll see, with the example from Mandukya Upanishad, as we, sir, has already mentioned, this original consciousness or Turiyam, the pure consciousness, is present, immanent, and transcendent in all the three of layers of consciousness: the deep sleep state, the awake state, and the dream state. So this is the complete understanding of the verse, where we should see original consciousness as the Sakshi Chaitanya principle witness, which is not subject to arrival and departure, as Madam said previously, and it is present, immanent, and transcendent. Hari Om.
Thank you, Dr. Sachin, for a nice explanation of a very important sadhana. And this sadhana or this methodology is worked out very nicely in Taittiriya Upanishad in Brahmananda Valli, and again in the Bhrigu Valli, which is the third section of Taittiriya. And Bhagwan is trying to help us to move from Vigraha, that means my body, Indriya, sense organs, Prana, Di means my intellect, to Tamaha, Anandamaya Kosha. So progressively, like a mountaineer goes from one level, I am making my mind more and more sensitive to understand that I am not my body, I am not my mind, I am not my prana, I am not my intellect, I am not even the Anandamaya Kosha, then who am I? So this is a process of subtlety to be inquiring, because all these are all inert, are jadam, or a matter principle. They are not as real, not as permanent as the consciousness. So this is the evolution. All of us need to understand two things very clearly. I am conscious, I understand. But to understand what is this existence, what is this consciousness that lends existence? And this understanding can be possible. It may take many years, but this is what we really need to understand, that I as Atma lend consciousness to this body, I enliven this body, and I give existence to the same world. And that is how the Upanishads claim, my eva sakalam jatam, my sarvam pratishtitam. If this understanding is not there, these will just remain as mere words. With that, we will conclude our class today. We will have the last set of verses after we complete this eighth chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. This eighth chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, Swamiji calls it as an odd man out chapter. This is what we are going to study in the next class, because this deals with a different kind of mukti called Krama Mukti. All the rest of Vedanta wants us to get mukti or Jivan Mukti in this life itself. We have got a guru, we have got a human birth, we have got this opportunity of mokshutvam. Don't lose this opportunity before the body drops. Let us become a mukta purusha. But for some reason, if it is not possible, and this is also discussed in our scriptures, the Bhagavad Gita, being a comprehensive text, includes what is called Krama Mukti. It begins with a very interesting question based on the discussion of the concluding part of the seventh chapter, where Arjuna asks certain questions. What is Brahma? What is Karma? What is Adhyatma, Adibhutam, Adidaiva? Who is this Adi Yajna? All interesting aspects, but very simply answered. But the rest of the whole chapter devotes on one thing: how to remember Ishvara at the time of death. And this is possible only if we become a Ishvara Upasaka. Saguna Ishvara Dhyana is an important time. That means all the time, even as I am doing this, can the background Shruti of my life be based on Ishvara? And if I am based on Ishvara in and through everything, and this is the crux of the eighth chapter, if you are able to become an Upasaka, if every action that I do becomes a form of an Ishvara Upasana or Ishvara Arpana, then what happens? My death, I will remember Ishvara at the time of death, and Ishvara is going to give me mukti either here or hereafter. About that, I need not worry. We will have a chanting of these verses by our young Aditi from verses 16 to 22. Over to you, Aditi.
Shri Gurubhyo Namah. Drishyavaritam Chittam Atmanah Chitvadarshanam Tatvadarshanam Manasam Tukim Margane Krite Naiva Manasam Marga Arjavat Vrittayastvaham Vrittimashritah Vrittayo Mano Vidyaham Manah Ahamayam Kuto Bhavati Chinvatah Aipatatyaham Nijavicharanam Ahaminashabha जहमहंतया स्फुरतिरित्स्वयं परमपूर्णसत् इदमहं पदा विक्यमन्वहम् अहमिलीनके प्यलयसत्तया विग्रहेन्द्रिया प्राणदीतमः नाहमेकसत् तज्जडं ह्यसत्। हरिओम्।
Thank you, Aditi, for the wonderful rendition of the verses. It was truly a mesmerizing chanting, transporting us to Ramanashrama. I'm sure Bhagavan will be mighty pleased with your flawless devotional chanting and has showered his blessings on you. Thank you, Dr. Timmappa Hegde, sir, for your transformative insights flowing from the depth of your experiential understanding. Grateful thanks to all the speakers for a very illustrative presentation, making the intense works look so simple. If I may summarize today's learnings, Atmavichara, self-inquiry, is the surest means of permanently subsiding the mind. Mind has no existence of its own and ceases to function once its nature is revealed. The mind is only an identity of the self with the body. Seek the source of the I thought. When the false I vanishes and merges into its source, and the true I appears. The real I is ever existent. Panchakosha, apart from the self, is Jada. But when the self is realized, they are found within the self, Satchit. Today's verses of Upadesha Saram has given us a fair understanding of the real I, the Brahman, which will help us in a much better comprehension of the 8th chapter on Akshara Brahma, starting from the next session. Let's continue our Mananam and Nididhyasanam based on today's Shravanam till we meet next on the 8th of November 2021 at 6:45 p.m. Indian Standard Time. May Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi's grace strengthen our resolve for Atma Vichara. Om Namo Bhagavate Shri Ramanaya. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। ओम शांति ही, शांति ही, शांति ही। हरिओम।